reminding you to tune in every Friday night at 6 o'clock for live in-studio performances by some of the very best artists from around the state playing here in-studio doing what they do best. And don't forget, rebroadcast times are Saturday mornings at 9 a.m. and Monday and Wednesdays at 7 p.m.
This hour on WMNH is proudly sponsored by CGI Business Solutions, located at 171 Londonderry Turnpike in Hooksett. Serving all your employee benefits planning, design and administration, investment and wealth management, and customized business insurance solutions. They are available at 866-841-4600 or on the web at cgibusinesssolutions.com.
You are listening to WMNHLP, Manchester's radio, broadcasting at 95.3 megahertz frequency modulation from the top of 1000 Elm Street. Our studios are located at 1045 Elm Street and licensed to Manchester Public Television Service in Manchester, New Hampshire, USA.
Yo. Shout to everybody. Who's been on this trip with me. You don't have to agree, but if you feel like me,
someone get this Aryan a sheet. Time to bury him, so tell him to prepare to get impeached. Everybody on your feet. This is where terrorism and heroism meet, square off in the street. This chump barely even sleeps. All he does is watch Fox News like a parrot and repeats while he looks like a canary with a beak. Why you think he banned transgenders from the military with a tweet? He's trying to divide us, this like a cult, but like Johnny, he'll only unite us. Cause nothing inside us drives us like this fight does. Similar to when two cars collide, cause our spirits crushed in this spot's a tight one. But here the jaws of life come to pull us from the wreckage, that's what we get pride from. When we can't from our stars and stripes, this type of pickle that we're in's hard to deal. But there's always tomorrow still, if we start from scratch, like a scab, get the scars to heal. And band together for Charlottesville and for Heather. Fallen heroes, fill his wall with murals. Not bad, I get up, hit the damn resetter. Let's start from zero, this is our renewal. Spray tan, get rid of, get a brand new better America. And here's to where it all
began.
Piss your face off, did you? Can't denounce the Klan cause they play golf with you. You stay on Twitter, way to get your hate off, Nazi. I do not see a way y'all differ. And all you got are race cards, big at the swastika with your name carved in it. Should be your trademark, cause hate's all you played off. And you just licked the plate off, so I guess it pays to feed off of chaos. So basically you ate off Hitler. But you ain't ruining our country, punk, or taking our pride from us. You won't define us, cause like a dictionary, things are looking up so much. Got a sprained neck, no, we will rise up against this train wreck and take a stand. Even if it means sitting when they raise the flag to sing the Star Spangled Banner. This man just praised the statue of General Lee, cause he generally hates the black people, degrades Hispanics. Take it back to the shady National Convention. Wish I would've spit on it before I went to shake his hand at the event, or maybe had the wherewithal to know that he was gonna try to tear apart our sacred land. We cherish and stand for, so hands in the air, let's tear it for the start of a brand new America. Without him, then be proud of where we're from. And here's to where it
all began. There's no place like home. I won't give up. I won't give up on my home. That so many died for. You already know that I won't give up. I won't give up on my home. That so many died for. You already know. There's no place like home. No place like home. Wherever I go. No place like home.
Stand up.
Into the land and
my God, I'm president. I'm so rich and I'm an ass. And there's a wig on my head. I just FaceTime Putin. I told him I'm his biggest fan. Got so much scandal on the front page. Holy shit, let's build a wall. Ooh, I can tweet so well. Wonder if I can say the N-word. Wait, can I really say the N-word?
North Korea. North Korea. In North Korea. North Korea. North Korea.
In North Korea.
North Korea.
North Korea.
North Korea.
North Korea. I woke up in Donald Trump's body. So orange overweight and slightly balding. Now I got no choice but to ruin this country.
Says who?
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Hey, everybody, welcome. It's that time again. Matt Connerton, Unleashed in the Afternoon. We are live on WMNH 95.3 FM, emanating from downtown Manchester, New Hampshire, streaming at WMNHradio.org. You can also find WMNH on the TuneIn app, so you can easily take us wherever you go. It's a great thing to have on your mobile device. Of course, you can also watch on Channel 97 Comcast if you're in the Manchester area, and if that were not enough, on Facebook via Facebook Live on the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page. Hello to, I see Christian Cunard is already in there. Hello, Christian. And she says, hello, Matt. And AJ Davis from Common Sense Radio. He says, Friday. Yes, that's why I played the Little Dicky Freaky Friday Trump parody. Now, you might notice if you are watching me, whether it be on Channel 7, Channel 97, rather, or on Facebook Live, that there is something conspicuous by its absence here on the desk. And it is the conspicuously absent item in question that this may be a slightly different show. Actually, this is kind of old school for me. I'm doing the show old school today in the sense that when I first started doing the show here at WMNH, as I am today, I just realized I didn't give the date. I like to give the date. It is, of course, Friday, September 14th, the year of our Lord, 2018. You know, I usually have my computer here, and I plug my computer, that computer that you usually see sitting right here. If you're watching, you can see how it's empty here. I'm reminded of you know, All in the Family, I think, greatest sitcom in the history of television. And I'm reminded of that episode of All in the Family where Archie comes home and finds his television is not where it should be. And then he, you know, nobody says anything about it. They just kind of wait for him to, like, Edith just waits for him to notice. And then he's like, he stands where the television is supposed to be. And he, like, spins around in a circle. He's, like, going, why isn't it here or something? It's much funnier if you see the clip on YouTube. Not right now. Stay with me for now. You can always watch it later. But I'm reminded of that. So my computer is not here. My computer is fine. There's nothing wrong with it, but I usually bring it with me. I have it plugged into the board. I have audio on my computer queued up and ready to go that I plan to feature on the show. But it is at home in the office, and there's nothing wrong with it or anything. What happened is I had to do some unexpected last-minute running around this afternoon. I had to run up to Concord and whatnot, and I should have just taken my computer with me, but I didn't, and it's at home, and I'm here. And I did not have time to, as things have unfolded today, I did not have time to go home and get my computer. So I'm here without my computer. So I feel naked without it. I'm not going to lie. But that's okay. So I've got the, of course, the Facebook Live open on this monitor, as it always is. But I also have it open on this computer over here. And again, if you're watching, you can see. So that's why I have to look over here awkwardly to see people's various comments and so forth. But we shall adapt and overcome. And we have a call. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton, Unleashed in the Afternoon. Who's this?
Hey, Ridley again.
Ridley again. How are you, sir?
Yes, that's Mr. Ridley again to you.
Oh, Mr. Buck. Ridley again. That's, wow. Now, is that hyphenated? Is the Ridley again hyphenated?
It better be spelled correctly.
I think it should be. I think it demands a hyphen.
Okay, well, whatever. But I was calling because I never imagined I would call talk radio five times in a row to discuss the Libertarian Party because I thought they were so boring back in the day. But I have right. yet another piece of news for you about them.
Mm. All right, let's hear it.
So Gilletta Jarvis, who is or was the gubernatorial candidate, their governor candidate.
Yes.
I don't know who won the election, but she had a rally shortly preceding the election to call for DCYF reform.
That's a big issue with hers. Yeah. Like if you look at her social media, that's something she really focuses on. And she brought it up, too, when she was here, when I interviewed her a couple of weeks ago. Yes.
So for those who don't know, that's the state's child protective bureaucracy. And she, at this rally, she had claimed before the rally, maybe a week or two before, that someone was getting threatened, one of her speakers. And that just was sort of mentioned and then forgotten. And then I saw this more recent post that was really kind of dramatic. She says, quote, "Help, need armed security."
Oh.
Unquote. And so she was calling for people with guns to show up at the rally because she was worried about the safety of one of the speakers, she
wow.
said.
Oh, okay.
And then apparently someone did show up, like of the person who allegedly did the threatening actually did show up.
No kidding.
And apparently they did have the armed security, and the person just like circled the rally in a car and then left.
Hmm. Wow.
Now that's what I don't have independent confirmation of that. That's just what Gilletta Jarvis claims on her Facebook page.
Now, does anyone know or has she identified or has anyone identified who the individual is who was making the threats?
It would really be nice if someone would, or if someone had gotten video or something, or if I had gone.
Yes.
Like, if I'd gone, then I could have done that myself, right? I could have gotten video myself. But I didn't go, so I can't complain too much. But again, it's just this additional reminder that they're out there, they're doing stuff, and if you just do stuff, then something's going to happen that's interesting enough that the news will talk about it or mm-hmm. people will talk about it. And
yeah.
I definitely thought this was worth talking about.
So who is the individual who showed up who was armed, who showed up for protection? Do we know that?
Oh, no, I don't know. Just let it say in her post. I'm just passing along what she posted. And
yeah.
And if they, and if she did name a name, I'd almost be reluctant to repeat that on the air, but just because of the fact that I don't know enough to
right.
know. I mean, it's just Gilletta's claim, but she is the Libertarian Party, or was the Libertarian Party candidate for governor. I don't know which is or was. And
now what?
You know, she's not a nobody.
Yeah.
So
now why do you say that, Dave? She is or was? Is there still some question about whether she actually is the Libertarian nominee?
I don't know who won the election. The last I heard, it was still being recounted or something.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because I think when we had talked, was it yesterday or the day before, she was the apparent nominee, but then Aaron Day is launching a request for a recount or something. Oh, there was an issue, too, about Libertarian voter suppression because they weren't giving out the ballots, or they were putting the ballots somewhere separate, like over by the coffee machine or something at some of these polling places, instead of having them ready or something, or telling people the dog ate them or something, or
that
whatever
is,
was going on.
That is another claim by someone in the Libertarian Party, maybe multiple people in the Libertarian Party of New Hampshire.
Yeah. Very interesting. Well, I'm glad that someone was there to protect against this the individual who's been making the threats, and it sounds like it may have scared that person off. So that's good. I'd be curious to know who it is and why they're making threats. But very interesting. Anything else on your mind today,
well,
Dave?
It seems really weird that someone. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Oh no, I was just asking you if there was anything else on your mind as we head into the weekend. But no, if you have more to say about this, please go ahead.
Yeah, it seems weird that someone would show up at the rally. You know, like what she was claiming was that the person who was going to show up was the person who had been abusing one of the speakers.
Yeah,
who was complaining about, you know, DCYF related abuse.
Mm-hmm.
But why would someone like that show up at a rally? I mean, you'd think if they were going to be the bad guy and harass someone, they'd do it at any time but during the rally.
Yeah, unless they wanted the attention, you know. I don't know. Maybe they're trying to impress somebody and they want to be seen harassing someone. Who knows? But you seem to be approaching the whole thing with some journalistic skepticism.
Well, it's just a claim, right? You know, it's a claim by a politician, just like any other claim by a politician. It should be taken with a grain of salt.
Right. Well, that's very true.
But it's, you know, it's like I've always said. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh no, I was just agreeing with you. I was just saying, yeah, that's very true.
Yeah, but you know, it would be interesting to see. You know, I don't know what happened in the primary is not near as important as what happens in a general election. And if all the libertarians get just wiped off the map, you know, none of them wins anything, then that may be an indicator that this is kind of a waste of time. But that for now, they've got a lot of people who are really pretty good established activists who are not flakes, and they're active. And so they're, you know, it seems unlikely that you know, half of them would just go dark and get burned out. You know, probably some of them will be able to stick with it. And if they start getting more and more traction and they win two or three elections this season, then this could be sort of something that hasn't really happened in American politics before. You know, where you really got, you know, at least not since the Civil War, you know, it's a third party that's actually, you know, gaining steam. Maybe this sort of happened in the early part of the 20th century with some of the socialist parties, but it would be really interesting to see what exactly are the implications of having a strong third party. None of us even remember anything like that.
Yeah, the only other thing I can remember like that would be in 92 when Ross Perot was doing very well in the polls but I forget now, was he a member? I think he was, wasn't he? Didn't he choose to be with the Reform Party or something like that? I mean, he wasn't a libertarian, but I think he did attach himself to a party of some kind, a third party of some kind. I think it might have been the Reform Party. And I've always said Oh, go ahead, Dave.
I used to work for him.
Well, I didn't realize that. You worked for Ross Perot?
Yeah, for Ross Perot. Not directly, but I worked at Perot Systems. I was a contractor.
Oh, no kidding. Oh, that's interesting. Oh, I never knew that. I've always said that...
Yeah,
I was just going to say, I've always said, and a lot of people disagree with me on this, but although some agree with me, that in 92, if Perot hadn't flaked out the way that he did, if you remember, he was doing really well in the polls and whatnot, but then he suddenly got out of the race and he had some very strange, did that strange press conference where he had some strange convoluted explanation for why he was getting out, and then everyone called him a quitter and then he got back in. But I've always felt that if he had stayed the course and not flaked out where he got out and then got back in and all that, I actually think he could have won the presidency. I think he had a legitimate shot at it.
Yeah, and, you know, much of his agenda was adopted in 1994 by the Republican Congress, and much of his agenda was pro-freedom, and if it hadn't been pro-freedom, at least it was more multi-party than what we'd had before.
Yeah.
I still have a high opinion of him. I've met him and liked him, and you know, he showed up at an event once that I went to. He just sort of drove up in his sort of old Cadillac thingy and popped out of the car. No security. This is long after he was a huge public figure.
Yeah.
Just kind of down to earth. You know, I wanted to interview him, you know, and I had to talk him into it, you know, and he didn't know if he wanted to do it or not. He was just a very real person, you know?
Yeah. No, and it's funny. He's kind of a forgotten individual in American political history. You know, no one talks about him. If you bring up his name, people are kind of like, oh, yeah. But for a short time, he was a huge, huge figure in American politics. He was a big, big deal. And,
yeah, but again, the key word there is short time. You know, it's easy to have a flash in the pan. Even Ron Paul was really ultimately just a flash in the pan twice. And now everything he does, you know, he gets a little bit of media attention and stuff like that, but he's a non-factor pretty much now. And it's this question of whether you can keep up the energy for a long period of time and start gathering that gravity.
Right. Yeah. No, well, you know, I think he was kind of, I think if he were younger and he kept coming back to the trough, I think maybe he could have kept up that momentum. But, you know, I think he's pushing 80 now, isn't he, Ron Paul?
Yeah, or he could have just, you know, and I said this at the time, and I asked him about that. I think I sort of, no way, I can't remember if I asked him about this. Maybe I did, maybe I didn't ask him. I should have. He should have just moved to New Hampshire because he was the one that actually brought that up. He said in 2000 and early 2007, before he decided to run, that he was considering if he had trouble with his candidacy, he might move to New Hampshire and attempt some sort of local or statewide office in New Hampshire. He said statewide was the term that he used.
Okay.
That he never mentioned that again. That never came up again. He went back to Texas and just became ineffective after 2012. And if he'd just moved to New Hampshire, he would have had an electrical effect on liberty in the world. And he never did that.
Well, maybe he was kind of hoping that his son would really, you know, sort of pick up and carry that mantle. But so much for that.
Well, his son didn't even... I supported his son more than his son supported his son, right? Like, at least I stuck with it until the New Hampshire primary. Rand Paul quit before the New Hampshire primary.
Right. in 2016, yeah. And it's funny, too, because I think, like, maybe a year and a half before that, he had all this positive buzz. He was on, I think it was the cover of Time or Newsweek, as they called him the most interesting man in politics. And then... But it all dissipated. That was such a that field of Republicans, you know, if you take, you know, maybe excluding Trump, but the rest of them were they were all trying to out pro war each other. And Rand Paul and Trump himself to some extent, but Rand Paul especially was the one real sort of anti-war candidate on that stage. And, you know, let's be honest, a large swath of the Republican Party, they're very excited about war and think it's pretty awesome and cool. And I think that's part of what did Rand Paul in. He just, you know, he didn't seem particularly, I mean, he was the one who, I'll never forget it. You know, everybody else on the stage, again, Trump is kind of an outlier, but everybody else is, you know, like Chris Christie and Carly Fiorina and whatnot. You know, they're talking about Putin and how terrible Putin is and how they can't wait to just go to war with Russia. I mean, no one literally quite said that, but they all sounded like they were ready to, like on day one in office, they were going to start launching some missiles. And Rand Paul, I remember at one point, you see him on camera just kind of shaking his head. And he did say very bluntly, he said, "You people are going to get us all killed," but I think,
oh, that's great.
Yeah.
And he, again, it's important not to, you know, it's so easy to when somebody gets five things right, you want to complain about the sixth thing that they didn't get right.
Sure.
And Rand Paul does have that. He has the demeanor down. He has a balanced approach, you know, and he's credible. He's really actually been a pretty good senator. I don't have much to complain about in his Senate. You know, he makes a lot of noise. He filibusters. He's good. You know, it's just he should. I mean, if he was going to run for president, I think he should have run for president, and not, you know, and not failed to run for president, which was pretty much what he did. He pretty much failed to run for president when he was running for president.
Yeah. No, I agree with you. I agree with you. Well, Dave, anything else on your mind today before we let you go?
Can't think of anything.
Well, please give the Ridley Report a plug.
Ridley Report, something. Ridley Report.
Very good. All right, Dave Ridley from theridleyreport.com. Thank you for the call, my friend.
Okay, ciao.
All right, take care. Bye-bye. All right, Dave Ridley leaves us. That opens up a line for you on this Friday afternoon, 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007. Hello to Peter White, who joins us in the Facebook live chat. Peter White, of course, the host of the morning show with Peter White and the Moose. I was listening to the morning show, and it sounded like, Eric Gagnon, who does the entertainment report, he sounded a little, he sounded a little off today. I hope Eric's all right, because we need him. We need him for our, he picks Band of the Week or whatever and TV Show of the Week, and it's very exciting. There is news. Paul Manafort pleads guilty and reaches a cooperation agreement. It'll be very interesting to see what happens now. Of course, this is all, as we know, as Trump and others keep reminding us, it's really all just a witch hunt, right?
One of these witch hunts where you just walk out of your front door right. And all the witches are just landing in your front lawn.
Right there in the yard.
Thank you, Joe Scarborough. Yes, it's quite the quote-unquote witch hunt. Let's see. TheHill.com reports today that former Trump campaign chairman Paul Manafort pleaded guilty to two federal charges today in a deal that includes cooperation with special counsel Robert Mueller's investigation. Judge Amy Berman Jackson said in court on Friday, today, that Manafort has agreed to submit to interviews with the special counsel, testify in any future cases, and provide related documents. According to the plea agreement filed in court Friday afternoon, Manafort must cooperate, quote, fully, truthfully, completely, and forthrightly, unquote, with the Justice Department in any and all matters that the government finds cooperation to be relevant.
When did they flip you? Tell me. Don't lie.
Manafort has also agreed to forfeit several properties and the current funds held in several bank accounts. I plead guilty, Manafort told the judge quietly. Oh, I'm sorry. I should have pre-read this. Let me try that again. I plead guilty, Manafort told the judge quietly after answering a series of questions from the judge. Manafort gave the guilty plea on one count of conspiracy against the United States and one count of conspiracy to obstruct justice by witness tampering. Now, you youngins listening, let that be a lesson to you. No witness tampering and no conspiring against the United States. These things are bad. You don't want to end up like Mr. Manafort. I mean, yeah, it might be fun for a while. You get to wear some very expensive suits and stuff. But at the end of it, you end up in prison for the rest of your life. I think that this is a cautionary tale and a teachable moment. I don't mean to lecture. I don't mean to preach. I'm just saying. I know that, because, as I often discuss on the show, I try to be very contemporary with the program. I try to keep it very young and hip, use a lot of the language that the young people use. Like yesterday on the show, I was talking about keeping it crunk or something like that. I think that's something the young people say. So I know a lot of the young folk listen to this program. So I just, let this be a lesson to you, what has happened to Mr. Manafort. If you find yourself in the future in a position to conspire against the United States government and to commit obstruction of justice by witness tampering, like I said, it might look like fun for a while, but there is a price to pay. So anyway, there's more here. The sentencing guidelines indicate Manafort could face between 210 and to 262 months in prison for the crimes and pay a fine of $40,000 to $400,000. Now, I'm not good at math, my friends. As I often say, I failed college accounting the first time I took it, but 210 to 262 months, that sounds like a lot of years. I don't know how many years that is. I'm going to actually use my phone and open up the calculator. I want to know. So 210 months. Okay, so 210 divided by 12. That's 17 and a half years. Mr. Manafort is, what is he? He's in his 60s, right? He's like 62 or something. Yeah, so he's going to die in prison is what I'm getting at here, my friends. So again, you young folk, this is not something you want to do. Because once you're in prison, there is no getting crunk, is what I'm trying to communicate to you, right? At least I don't think so. I don't think there's any crunk in prison. I think it's like one of the things you get taken away from you when you go to prison. Let's see, it says here, but Berman said the statutory guidelines cap the sentence at 5 years for each count, and that prosecutors have agreed a sentence capped at the guideline range would be reasonable. Maybe he won't spend the rest of his life in prison. But regardless, even with these caps, so when he gets out, it'll be a little crusty, I would think. She also said prosecutors will file a request for a lesser sentence based on the value of information Manafort provides in cooperating with their investigation. But she said she does not have to accept that request. Prosecutors and Manafort's defense attorneys agreed to file a joint status report by November 16th. Mueller filed a superseding criminal information earlier on Friday, laying out a series of allegations related to Manafort's work lobbying on behalf of pro-Russia forces in Ukraine that had already been charged in previous court filings. Prosecutors allege that Manafort, conspiring with his former business partner Richard Gates and Russian associate, this is one of those moments where I have to pronounce a foreign name. If you're new to the show, this is always exciting to see how this works out. Russian associate Konstantin Kilimnik. I think it's Kilimnik. Hey, that's not bad. I'm going to give myself a pat on the back. That's not bad. Konstantin Kilimnik. I think I handled that pretty well. But to be fair, I mean, that was a last name with only three syllables. Some of these Russian last names have 28 syllables and they're all consonants. That one was all right. Konstantin Kilimnik illegally lobbied on behalf of a foreign government by failing to register as a foreign agent. Again, young people, let this be a lesson to you. If you're going to work on behalf of a foreign government, you need to register as a foreign agent. And I'm concerned. I'm concerned that the guidance counselors in the local high schools are not communicating this to the graduating classes. This is something you need to know to succeed in the world. And in this case, by succeed, I mean to not end up in prison. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton, Unleashed in the Afternoon. Who's this?
Hi, it's Pandora.
Pandora, how are you? It's wonderful to hear from you. What's on your mind?
Well, I'm trying to get my friend to stop faking that she just had a seizure after she supposedly died after she had gotten bitten. So I was wondering if you can convince her.
Okay. You might have to repeat that for me, Pandora. I'm not sure I quite understood. You're trying to convince your friend of what exactly? Are you trying to convince your friend not to conspire with a foreign government? Or was there something else in there? Please repeat that.
Yeah, not to conspire with the foreign government.
Not to conspire with a foreign government. Yes. Okay. So is your friend listening right now?
Yep.
Okay, so I would say this, Pandora's friend, hopefully you're paying attention, and I would try to convince you at the behest of Pandora, please do not conspire with a foreign government. Doing so will very often result in an incredibly lengthy prison term, and once you are in prison, there is no getting it crunk. So hopefully your friend will heed my words.
Yep.
Do they say that, Pandora, at your school? Do they still talk about crunk?
Nope.
Oh, okay. What about
kinda.
A kind of. What about like do they still say keeping it real? Is that like still a thing?
Hold on. Did I say keeping it real?
I mean, I would hope so.
No, she's giving me the silent treatment for no reason whatsoever.
She's giving you the silent treatment. Well, she probably had aspirations to conspire with a foreign government, and now she's a little bitter now that I've set her straight. You know.
Okay, I got it.
Oh, my goodness. I mean, the truth can be a bitter pill to swallow. Well, Pandora, anything else today on your mind? Anything else?
Hi.
Hi. Is that your friend?
Yep, that's Valencia.
Now, does your friend, does she hang out with any Ukrainians?
Wait, can I? Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
When is this going to be on the radio?
This is actually on the radio right now. We are live on WMNH 95.3 FM.
I would like to sing.
You'd like to sing? Is this a Ukrainian song, or is this some good American music?
Good American.
Well, thank goodness, because this is an American show, and we love America. Please go ahead, sing for us.
Okay.
That's racist. Right.
Stop. Don't say that. All right, ready?
I'm ready.
All right.
I hope this is clean. Right. This has to be clean for FM radio. No swearing.
Yep, it's clean.
Okay,
I'm too
good.
Young to be swearing.
Oh, good, good. Yes, you do sound so. Yes, go ahead.
Listen to the song here in my heart, a melody I start but can't complete.
Very nice.
Listen to the sound from deep within. It's only beginning to find relief. Oh, the time has come for my dreams to be heard. They will not be pushed aside and turned into your own. All 'cause you won't listen. I am alone in the crossroads. I'm not at home in my own home. Well, I've tried and tried to say what's on my mind. You should have known. Oh,
wow.
Now I'm trying to believe in you. You don't know what I'm feeling. I'm more than what you made of me. I followed the voice you gave of me. But now I gotta find my own.
Very nice. Very nice. What a lovely song. I couldn't quite catch all the lyrics. Is that, what was the song about? Is that about America?
Oh, no. There's a different song. So that song was by Beyonce. Do you know who Beyonce is?
I do know who Beyonce is. I do have it on good authority,
Beyonce
though.
Beyonce made that song.
I have it on good authority that Beyonce, along with Jay-Z, are a part of the Illuminati. And that they have a secret pact with George Soros, but I can't confirm any of that. But yes, I'm very familiar with Beyonce. Well, thank you for calling us up and singing to us, and I hope will you call back in another day and serenade us again.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Matt.
Yes.
I was wondering.
We can Pandora, you got to get closer to the phone. I mean, I can hear you, but I don't think the listeners can.
I'm sorry.
Oh, that's okay. Yes.
I was wondering if you could ask Peter to play this on Saturday.
You have a request for Peter White to play something on Saturday?
No, to play the show on Saturday.
Oh, well, I don't think he can because on Saturdays it's replays of the morning show all week. But I can tell you this, Pandora, after I get off the air today, this will be available on WMNHradio.org. So you'll be able to play it back there.
Okay.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Very good. Well, Pandora, thank you so much. And it was nice to meet your friend and have a great weekend. And I hope we'll talk to you again next week.
Bye. Okay, you too.
Okay, bye-bye. All right, well, that was very nice. I wasn't expecting to be serenaded. Apparently, Granite State of Mind this evening will be something pre-recorded, so I'm here till 6 p.m. Sometimes on Fridays, we wrap up a little bit early because Rob has live musicians coming and play, but doesn't sound like he's going to be here today. So thank you, Joe, for letting me know, texting me that. So you get the full Matt Connerton Unleashed experience today. Lucky you. But I have all this great advice to dispense. And, you know, and what was nice about that call, too, is because it sounded like Pandora's friend was right on the edge of conspiring with the Ukrainians against the United States. And I think I saved her. I think I saved her future. And that's a good feeling. And that's really what I try to do. I'm here for the kids. Let's see. Getting back to this, we'll finish up on Manafort, and then we'll move on to some other things. Wow, it's already 20 minutes of 5. This is flying by. Hello to Dr. Jeff Cassell, who joins us in the Facebook live chat. As I always say, Dr. Cassell, you're welcome anytime here in the studio. Prosecutors allege that Manafort laundered more than $30 million from his work to buy property and other items in the United States, evading more than $15 million in taxes. Again, that's also a big no-no. By pleading guilty, Manafort is admitting to all of the alleged crimes with which he is charged that were related to his foreign lobbying efforts. He is also admitting guilt to 10 bank and tax fraud charges that a jury could not reach a consensus on in his August trial in Virginia, though he will not be charged on those counts as part of the plea agreement. The guilty plea will allow Manafort to avert a second trial in Washington, D.C. Oh, that's interesting. Okay. Stemming from Mueller's probe. He faced 7 separate charges in that case, including failing to register as a lobbyist for a foreign country, conspiracy to commit bank fraud, and obstructing justice for witness tampering. Wow, I said it so easily before, and now I struggle with it. Kilimnik, there we go. Kilimnik was charged alongside Manafort in June with conspiracy to obstruct justice, but is unlikely to see his day in court because he is Russian and therefore out of reach of U.S. prosecutors. Well, lucky him. I guess it pays to be Russian if you're going to get involved in this money laundering stuff. Prosecutors had offered Manafort the opportunity to have a single trial on all charges, but he refused, forcing prosecutors to bring charges both in the Eastern District of Virginia and in Washington. Manafort's Virginia trial generated considerable attention from the public and the media. At that trial, Gates, who is cooperating in Mueller's probe, testified against him in dramatic form. A jury in Alexandria convicted Manafort on 8 counts of bank and tax. Okay, I'm going to move on from this. It's because a lot of this we already know, and it's a bit of a rehash and so on and so forth. But my friends, again, as I said before, I think Paul Manafort is going to prison for a very long time. But who knows? I mean, could a pardon be forthcoming from the president? Because, you know, the president had many glowing things to say about Manafort recently, so we shall see. Now, how does this potentially affect Trump? Well, TheHill.com also reporting Rudy Giuliani has weighed in on how this may affect Trump. And, of course, Rudy, you know, he always does such a great job for... Always does such a great job for the president. Never makes anything worse than it already is. Giuliani, according to The Hill, says Trump has nothing to be concerned with on Manafort's deal. Well, of course, he's going to say that. But here, let's we'll dive into this a little bit. Rudy Giuliani told The Hill that Trump has nothing to be concerned about from Paul Manafort's decision to cooperate with prosecutors. Manafort, Trump's former campaign chairman, pleaded guilty to additional charges. Okay, so we know all that. So Giuliani said if Manafort had incriminating evidence on Trump, special counsel Robert Mueller's team, quote, would have had him plead to a conspiracy that would encompass the president, unquote. Well, I mean, actually, Giuliani, you know, sometimes he starts rambling and says a lot of crazy sounding things and whatnot, but he may very well be correct about that. Hello to Jeff Lorenz, also known as Scumpy, whom you can very often hear on the morning show with Peter White. He says, hi, Matt. Well, hello, Scumpy. Always nice to hear from you. Giuliani also criticized Mueller's team, naming prosecutor Andrew Weissman specifically, for failing to dampen the idea that Manafort could be cooperating against Trump. Giuliani said, quote, one of the things they should do if they were ethical is to cut off the speculation, unquote, claiming that he used to do this in his days as a federal prosecutor if there was erroneous speculation in the media about one of his cases. White House Press Secretary Sarah Huckabee Sanders had already sought to minimize the significance of the Manafort news as it pertained to Trump. Quote, this had absolutely nothing to do with the president or his victorious 2016 presidential campaign. It is totally unrelated, unquote. Again, that may very well be true. You know, I'm not one to say that, you know. Here's the thing. So, Manafort's woes, again, it may be what Sanders is saying, what Giuliani is saying. Yes, it may very well be that Trump has absolutely nothing to do with any of this. I would say this, though. It is interesting that Trump somehow managed to, you know, he told us he was going to surround himself with the best people, really great people, and he somehow manages to surround himself with criminals. Again, we can talk all about it. We can talk about it all we want to and say, well, it's a witch hunt. It's a witch hunt. But I'll tell you, this is one hell of a witch hunt. I'm not sure, you know, I mean, at what point, how many convictions and indictments and cooperating witnesses do you need before something stops being a witch hunt? Now, there are those who would argue, well, it's a witch hunt in that they're trying to get Trump. And that part's a witch hunt because he didn't do anything wrong. To which I say, well, even if you're a Trump supporter, I don't understand how you can be so absolutely certain that he didn't do anything wrong, number one. Number two, if you're a Trump supporter and you are absolutely certain that he didn't do anything wrong because, you know, Donald Trump is, you think he's just this incredible ethical person and he's just pure of the as the driven snow and he's never done anything wrong. If you really believe that, then you should support the investigation. I say this all the time. Stop calling it a witch hunt and support the investigation, because if you truly believe in your guy, then one would assume that you would believe that this investigation will ultimately exonerate Trump. So, you know, because I constantly see and hear and read people saying, oh, Mueller needs to hurry up and show us his cards. You know, if he allegedly has something on Trump, he needs to hurry up and put it out there and show us what he's got. Well, of course, investigations don't work that way. It's over when it's over. You don't put a timetable on it. But also, too, what's the hurry? Again, if you really believe, if you're so convinced that there's no way that Donald Trump did anything wrong, there's no collusion, and even if there is collusion, collusion's not a crime, and all that. If you're so certain of all this, then you should want this to proceed to its natural conclusion and exonerate your guy, right? So, let's see. There's a little bit more here. Giuliani always has a lot of interesting things to say, so we'll continue with that for a moment. Again, this is from thehill.com. Giuliani drew an analogy to make his point regarding the crimes to which Manafort is pleading. Quote, if two people committed a bank robbery, you are not going to have one plead guilty to income tax evasion. How does that make sense? Then it comes to trial and the defense says, oh, you didn't plead guilty to robbing the bank, but you're saying my guy did? Unquote. What? Well, there's a problem with that very colorful analogy. And I'm not the only one who thinks so. It says here, Mark Zaid, a D.C.-based attorney who has represented clients from both major parties, said Giuliani's view was nonsensical. Zaid said, quote, incriminating information that Manafort may, with an emphasis on may, have, may not be criminal activity that Manafort himself was involved in, unquote. Asked whether it was possible that Manafort could cooperate against the president even while pleading guilty on unrelated charges, Giuliani replied, quote, technically, it's possible to do everything, but I happen to know it's not going to happen, unquote. Giuliani declined to comment on whether there had been any discussion of a possible presidential pardon for Manafort. There is also, may I just take a moment to remind everyone, there's the Al Capone analogy, which has been applied to Trump, which, again, this would be counter to what Giuliani is saying. You know, they got, how did they get Al Capone? They got him on tax evasion because they couldn't get him on anything else. They couldn't prove that he murdered any of the people he murdered. They couldn't prove a myriad of things, but they could get him on tax evasion. Oh. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed in the Afternoon. Who's this?
Hey, Matt, this is Frankie.
Frankie, how are you?
Great. I love the show, guy. Love the show.
Thank you.
That girl that was singing a minute ago has got a freaking voice of an angel, I'll tell you. She's really good.
She does, yes. And it was wonderful to have her serenade us. I was not expecting that.
It really wasn't. I tell you, she's listening. Keep up the good work. Shoot for your dreams. Shoot for the stars. That's how it is. So listen, I got a bone to pick with you, Matt Connerton Unleashed.
Yes.
I seized you at Walmart. You remember seeing me the other night at Walmart? We're in the cereal aisle. You remember?
Are you the same gentleman I ran into?
I'm the guy.
Oh.
And I said, and this for all the people in Radio Land, don't approach this guy, because I'll tell you, I asked for his autograph, and he turned, he says, I'm Matt Connerton Unleashed. You don't talk to me unless we're on the air. I said, Matt, what are you talking about? It's me. I've been listening. He goes, no, I'm Matt Connerton. I'm big time. So everyone, don't approach him. He's not approachable. I'm sorry, Matt. Catch out the bagpipe.
Well, here's the thing, Frankie, is that I have an explanation. I was feeling a little vulnerable because I didn't have my security detail with me. So I just so when someone approaches me, if I don't have, you know, because I typically have 7 or 8 armed people around me wherever I go. But
honestly, you came off a little standoffish. Well, you know, and as you get bigger, you know,
they've been on strike.
I've had a long time listening.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
You know, you're one of the guys that I think is approachable. I say, you know what, this guy's good on the radio. And I'll leave you with this. Next time I see you in public, I'm not going to say anything. Just know that I'm an admirer of the show and I'm a big fan. But I learned my lesson, all right? Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, you're not going to get fooled again, to quote George Bush. Holla at you, boy.
All right, thank you, Frankie. The thing is, I mean, too, you got to understand. I mean, when I'm out in public, and, you know, if I happen to not have my security detail with me and a gentleman such as Frankie approaches me, I mean, I don't know, is he really a fan or is he just trying to get close to me? And turns out he's looking to shank me. You know what I mean? He's got a shiv. He's looking to, I mean, anything can happen. I mean, Dave Ridley from the RidleyReport.com called earlier about, you know, the threat. Someone who was speaking at a Gilletta Jarvis event was being threatened and whatnot. I mean, you know, I feel I say controversial things. I feel threatened. And, you know, what if someone approaches me and I don't know. I mean, they might be. I mean, I remember one instance where I didn't have any security with me and someone recognized me and they approached me. And I'll tell you what, they said several stern and rude things. And then walked away and didn't allow me to respond. And it was very traumatizing for me. And then I have to, you know, carry that around with me for the rest of the day. I mean, that and then I'm feeling afraid and I'm vulnerable. And you have to understand, I mean, it's not easy. It's not easy out there in the world. And, you know, you got the paparazzi who are always trying to get to you and try to catch you in some sort of embarrassing moment and this and that. So, you know, I apologize, Frankie, but sometimes I've got my guard up. And then if my, you know, 12 or 15 security people, if they're currently on strike, apparently they want, I don't know, some silly stuff like health insurance or whatever. So, you know, I feel a little, I feel naked walking around out there. I'm in Walmart. I'm trying to get some cereal. And I just feel like at any moment, something truly, some terrible atrocity could be committed against me. I just don't know. And I have nightmares about these things. And so you understand, I mean, which probably is surprising given how well-adjusted and calm I am all the time. But I walk around all a quiver at what could possibly happen. So, you know, and it happens to a lot of radio personalities who reach a certain stature. Bill O'Reilly, before he fell into disrepute. I mean, he had some stories, you know, people stalking him and whatnot. And, of course, Sean Hannity. I mean, my goodness, that poor man. So, you know how it is. Or if you don't know how it is, hopefully I've explained it to you. You know, I'm out there in the world trying to get my crunk on, as I think the young people say now. And but there's a danger there, you know. And you always have to kind of be on guard. And you know, I try to be like a ninja, you know, and just know what's happening on all sides of me at any moment. Occasionally, I even dress like a ninja, and I'll wear the mask and everything. That can be inconvenient, though, because there's certain establishments that I go into looking like that. They'll ask me to take off the mask or the hood or whatever, and then it's like, now I don't feel like a ninja. I feel like I'm in danger. So, you know, these are the things that that celebrities go through. And, you know, I mean, sometimes, too, celebrities, you know, they end up cracking under the pressure. And they just can't handle it anymore, and that comes out on the air, and you don't want that. I mean, you know.
Traffic is good. That's it.
You know, you don't want that happening. So I try to deal with the pressure and the glare of the spotlight as well as I can. But occasionally I fail. I make mistakes, and I apologize. What I'm thinking about doing is actually I might start tweeting out. I got to get better about Twitter. I might start, if I'm feeling upset or insecure about something, maybe I can use Twitter to really express myself. And, you know, but then people will be psychoanalyzing me. And I certainly don't need any of that, you know, unless it's someone like Dr. Jeff Cassell, whom I really trust. Let's see. We're coming up on the top of the hour. Let's do one more quick thing. And then we'll take a quick break. Here on Matt Connerton, Unleashed in the Afternoon. By the way, 603-250-6007 is the number to call, 603-250-6007. Reuters reports Supreme Court nominee Kavanaugh denies sexual misconduct allegation. We have another Clarence Thomas, do we? No, probably not. But it says here, U.S. Supreme Court nominee Brett Kavanaugh today denied an allegation of sexual misconduct dating back to when he was a high school student, and a senior Republican senator said there was no reason to delay his confirmation to the court. Well, he is. I mean, it is. His confirmation is inevitable. Senator Dianne Feinstein, the top Democrat on the Senate Judiciary Committee, said on Thursday she received information about Kavanaugh from a person she declined to identify and that she had referred the matter to the Federal Bureau of Investigation. The New Yorker magazine reported on Friday that in July, shortly after Trump nominated Kavanaugh, Feinstein's office received a letter detailing a woman's alleged encounter with Kavanaugh while they were high school students. It said the woman had accused Kavanaugh of trying to force himself on her at a party, holding her down and covering her mouth with his hand, but that she was able to free herself. Neither Feinstein nor the magazine identified the woman. Kavanaugh, 53, said in a statement put out by the White House on Friday, quote, "I categorically and unequivocally deny this allegation. I did not do this back in high school or at any time," unquote. Democrats have fought Kavanaugh's nomination and are seeking to delay his confirmation. A spokesman for the committee's Republican chairman, Senator Chuck Grassley, today said the planned committee vote on Kavanaugh's confirmation would proceed next Thursday as scheduled. He said in a statement, quote, "Judge Kavanaugh has undergone 6 FBI full-fledged investigations from 1993 to 2018. No such allegation resembling the anonymous claims ever surfaced in any of those 6 FBI reports," unquote. Feinstein's office did not immediately respond to a request on Friday for comment. A conservative federal appeals court judge nominated by Trump to the lifetime position on the 9-member high court, Kavanaugh made no major missteps in questioning by senators during his confirmation hearing last week. He's pretty smooth. He got Kamala Harris pretty frustrated. Trump's fellow Republicans control the Senate by a narrow margin. Anyway, there's a little bit more here, but I do think his, you know, his confirmation is inevitable. This feels a little bit desperate to me on the part of Feinstein and the Democrats. An anonymous story going back to high school. I want to be, I always want to be very, very careful about how I comment on things like this because I don't want to be misunderstood. And there are those who will misunderstand no matter what I say. But so on the one hand, if this is true, then he's an attempted rapist. So that's obviously very, very bad, and he's a bad guy if this is true. On the other hand, we're talking about an anonymous tip, an anonymous story from someone all the way back in high school. I'm a big believer in innocent until proven guilty, and this is not in and of itself enough by a long stretch to convince me of anything. And again, I want to be careful about how I say that, because I don't want anyone to hear that and misunderstand and think that I take something like this lightly. I don't take something like this lightly. If this is true, then he's a POS. Or at least he certainly was in high school. I mean, that's how seriously I do take that, okay? To be very, very blunt. But it's anonymous. It's from high school. It's something that someone with a partisan motivation brought out, saying, oh, we received this letter. I don't know. It's a little thin. We do have the dynamic. This is, of course, you know, while this is going on, we have the backdrop of the Me Too movement. And the Me Too movement, I think, is a net positive. Women feeling free and empowered to come out and talk about the experiences they've had being abused, whether it's sexual assault or sexual harassment or whatever. I think it's a net positive, but, you know, nothing is black and white, and we always have to apply some nuance, which means, well, let me tell you, let me just to be clear what it does not mean. It does not mean we ever excuse anyone's bad behavior or rationalize it or justify it. We do not. But where the nuance and some critical thinking does need to be applied is, we do need to not just blindly accept every accusation that is made, again, especially under this circumstance, which is a little bit suspicious. It may be completely true, but we cannot deny him his confirmation, nor can we destroy his career and his public reputation, which is how this very often tends to end up, based on, again, something that's being presented anonymously from decades ago with a partisan motivation behind it. We have to still believe in, number one, innocent until proven guilty. Okay? That's still, you know, that's a hallmark of the justice system and Western democracy. Because we've seen, I'll tell you a very specific example where someone's career has been destroyed, and a lot of people have commented that, you know, they're not so sure this is fair. For anyone who hasn't been following it, just a quick backstory. So there's a comedian named Chris Hardwick. And Chris Hardwick, some may know from Nerdist. He started the website Nerdist and a podcast, the Nerdist podcast. That all started with him. And it grew, and the website grew to the point, and, you know, all these other people got involved. The website grew to the point where they've now pushed him out and, you know, and erased him from the website, the very thing he started. He also had a show on Comedy Central that was very popular for a few years called At Midnight. It was weeknights at midnight on Comedy Central. So some of you might know him from there. Anyway, Chris Hardwick went through a pretty bad breakup with a longtime girlfriend who, quite some time after the breakup, decided to publicly accuse him of some abusive behavior. And there are some credibility issues with her story, but it has not stopped his career from being destroyed. You know, he denies everything, and, you know, there's a lot of people who don't believe her. Now, that gets tricky, too, because if you say, you know, again, part of this is part of the Me Too movement. Part of it comes from political correctness. You're not allowed, as a general rule, you are not allowed to ever question the credibility of someone who is making an accusation. If you do, you are tagged as being, you know, a rape apologist, you know, and all kinds of things. You have to assume that the person making the accusation is being 100% honest, even though, in the end, it doesn't always turn out to be the case. But, to some extent, the Me Too movement and to some extent political correctness demands of us that we always assume that the accuser is telling the truth. But in the case of Chris Hardwick, like I said, a lot of people in the comedy community and people who, you know, there are text messages. Part of what has damaged her credibility and her story, her accusation against him, is these text messages that have been made public that seem to tell a very different story than the one that she is presenting. But, and she's not the one who released the text messages, by the way, obviously. She's not questioning the veracity of anything. She's not saying that those aren't real, right? She's not denying the text messages, but they tell a very different story than what she is claiming. So a lot of people are saying, no, Chris Hardwick has been wrongly accused by an ex-girlfriend who is upset with him and is now out to destroy him. And it's pretty clear that's what's going on here. But apparently that is not clear enough to enough people where he was able to escape having his career destroyed. And he's still in exile. You know, he built this little sort of empire online and then got a hit TV show on Comedy Central, and it's all been taken away from him because of an accusation made against him by an ex-girlfriend. It's not like a series of women have said things, too. This one woman made this accusation against him. And, you know, I think that, again, I think the Me Too movement's a net positive. But that doesn't mean that we just blindly accept everything. So if you're someone who, you know, you hear what Dianne Feinstein is saying and the accusation being made against Kavanaugh, you can't just go, oh, well, he's obviously that's true, and we have to deny him that seat on the Supreme Court. I mean, again, we have to, whether or not you like Brett Kavanaugh, we have to at least be fair. I mean, if you were accused of something like that, would you not want us to be fair and not just blindly believe your accuser? So, but that's the latest wrinkle. But in the end, it's not going to matter, right? Kavanaugh will be confirmed. I still believe that. Let's take a little break, shall we? Glenn R.J. Ouellette did just enter the room. Glenn R.J. Ouellette, of course, the people's mayor. He leaned his cane against the wall and then left with the bathroom key. So maybe he's just here to use the bathroom, or maybe he'll be joining us in a moment. But let's play a little song, shall we? And then we'll come back, and hopefully we will be joined here in the studio with the effervescent, the people's mayor, Glenn R.J. Ouellette. More Matt Connerton, Unleashed in the Afternoon, coming right up.
Truck. left wing, right wing, up wing, down. I see strip malls, we see the shining sea. It's the fat cat white developer who's created this whole damn squall. It's a pyramid scheme of dirty jobs, and who's gonna build your wall? We got fundamentalist Jews. We got fundamentalist Christians. They'll blow the whole thing up for you. But as I travel around this big old world, there's one thing that I most fear. It's a white man in a golf shirt with a cell phone in his ear.
Welcome back, everybody. Hour number two of, well, into hour number two. We don't worry about time that much on this show. It kind of ends up how it ends up. Matt Connerton Unleashed in the Afternoon. We are live on WMNH 95.3 FM, of course, on Channel 97 Comcast. If you're watching on via Facebook Live, and of course, you can stream anywhere in the world, WMNHradio.org. And joining me here in the studio, yes, it's true, the people's mayor, Glenn R.J. Ouellette, is here. How are you, sir?
And who's going to build your wall? No matter what Trump says, it won't be the Mexican government. It'll be the American taxpayer.
That's right. Hello to Ben Dion, host of The Weekly Dion, who joins us in the Facebook live chat. Of course, The Weekly Dion, Thursdays at 6 p.m. And by the way, Glenn, did you know that there's another new show coming to WMNH? Wednesdays at 6 p.m. immediately following this program will be a sports show.
Nice.
I don't know the details yet.
Is Mike doing it? The one who used to have it upstairs in the TV station?
No, I don't. No, I don't believe it's Mike Doyle. No, it's somebody else.
Oh,
but
well, that's good. We need that. Well, lots of sports in the city, especially in the winter.
Yeah, this is going to be a two-hour show from 6 to 8. So I don't know if they're I don't know if they're going to do local sports or if they're going to do
all
Boston sports.
I
don't know. I don't know.
Is
what's
it
going to
be
happen.
Once a week?
Once a week, yeah.
Well, that makes sense. Two hours.
Wednesdays, 6 to 8.
There's a lot of sports going around the world.
Yes, yes. What's on your mind today, sir?
Well, one thing I want to mention is because when I walked in, I noticed you were talking about Kavanaugh.
And the way you say his name, you made it sound Russian. Well, you made him sound Russian. What are you implying?
I'm French. It's the accent. Anyway, you are right. You can't have someone make accusations in a letter and then sign it anonymously and then say you don't want it to go any further. He has to be able, by law, that's our Constitution, to at least defend himself, say his side of the story, and even confront the accuser. That's the way it works in the courts.
You can't have someone just sign it how?
Anonymously.
Anonymous.
Well,
really
no, I'm not.
Anonymous.
I'm no Trump. My accent is bad, but not that bad.
Right, right. Yes. No, you said it correctly. Yes. Yeah. But he's going to be confirmed.
Probably so. I mean, he's another one of those that could probably commit a murder in New York and get away with it, right?
Right. I mean, the president certainly could do that and not lose any support. Not that we're saying the president's murdered anyone, Mike.
No,
goodness,
no, so. we're not saying that at all. We're just saying he said that he said he could and he would get away with it.
I never have either of you. You ever kill anybody?
No.
Yeah.
Why would you do that?
Have you ever been murdered?
Been murdered? I'm still here.
Oh, that's a good point. I've been really lucky, too. Like, I don't know. Like, sometimes I get, like, the other night, I don't know if you were listening earlier, Glenn, I had some guy approach me who's apparently, turns out he's a fan of the show, but I thought he was trying to shiv me.
Really?
Thought he was trying to shank me.
And he was here in the building?
No, oh. At Walmart.
Oh.
Turns out he called earlier. Turns out he's a fan, but when I encountered him, I thought, my security detail wasn't around, and I just, I felt vulnerable.
You needed Mary LeMay. She's a security lady.
Is she?
She's a...
she carry a blade?
I don't know about that, but she's what they call a bouncer.
Really?
Yeah.
I did see her at the bar. I assumed she was having a drink. She
No, not that kind of bouncer.
Oh, I saw her at the Shasta.
Maybe I'm using the wrong way. She protects people. Like, she would be your what?
Bodyguard?
Bodyguard, that's the word.
Well, that's exciting. What's her experience? Do you know? Can you give me a little bit about her resume?
She used to be Norm Moody's bodyguard. Remember? Now,
I do. Why is she no longer Norm's bodyguard?
Oh, I don't know if she's not, because they're still friends, but it's not. She said they say she used to be, so I'm only repeating what I heard.
Isn't that a song? If you'll be my bodyguard, I'll be your long-lost friend. what's
Paul
his name there?
Manafort.
Paul Manafort?
Oh, Manafort. He's not a fest. He's a fort.
Yes.
Well, anyway, if he does his entire sentence as it should be, he'd be 87. If he does the percentage that they're going to give him, he'll probably be only 77. That's still a long time to be in jail.
Yes.
He's about 70 years old now.
He won't be able to get crunk in jail.
No. Well, what do you mean by that? You mean he won't be able to get a pardon?
No, I just mean it's something the young people, I think, are saying now.
Oh, see, I thought it meant pardons. He can still be pardoned and get removed from jail.
I'm on the youth tip, Glenn R.J. Ouellette, yes.
Well, I know the youth tip won't pardon him.
Well, no, only the president can do that.
And do you really think he will? Because he's already decided that he has to comply now. And tell his story and tell the truth.
It wouldn't surprise me.
That's one more flip.
That's right, yes.
Who have we not flipped?
The Hill is saying that Alan Dershowitz is saying that this is actually a big win for Mueller.
Yeah, I look at it this way. All the president's men that have been fired have flipped, pretty much. Except for one. Well, he hasn't been charged yet. And that's Stone. They're still going after him.
Roger Stone, yes. John Hopwood's best friend. I think they go fishing together.
Oh, that's John Hopwood? Be careful, John. Miller might be after you as well.
When did they flip you?
Well, yes. I mean, he could be getting a visit.
I know all about flipping. For 30, 40 years, I've been watching flippers. It almost ought to be outlawed.
The president does not approve of flipping.
No, he doesn't believe that people should be telling the truth, huh?
That's right. Dershowitz.
Especially if it's going to harm somebody else.
Dershowitz said today that Paul Manafort's guilty plea earlier today was a big win for special counsel Robert Mueller in his investigation. He said, quote, potentially Manafort's guilty plea opens up lots of doors that probably haven't been opened before, unquote.
Which door do you want open? A to Z.
A to Z, huh? Does that what we do? We label doors by letter, Glenn R.J. Ouellette?
You can. It's either by numbers or by letters.
That, yes. He also said, quote, I think the point of view of Mueller, this is a big win. This is a big gain because it gets access to somebody, unquote.
And not only that, he's another one of those employees or hired by the Trump administration when he was campaigning for the party that claims, well, he was only there a few months, but he was there 5 months. And a lot happened in that 5 months that he had a lot to do with.
Yeah. Well, of course, he was there for the convention, which was pretty important.
A lot of things at the last minute got changed because of him. And
yes.
That wasn't done by himself.
Right.
We all know that.
Yeah. Here's something I just saw. Reuters is reporting this. Pompeo slams John Kerry for inappropriate meetings with Iran officials. I didn't know about this. Do you know anything about this, Leonard?
Is he talking about the past or now?
I believe he's talking about now. It says U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo today lambasted his predecessor, John Kerry, for meeting Iranian officials in back-channel talks and accused him of trying to undermine the Trump administration's policy toward Tehran. I didn't know that Kerry was meeting with
Iranian
officials.
That could be a slippery slope. I don't know what happened, so I can't say, but it could be a slippery slope. He's no longer Secretary of State.
Right. Pompeo told the news conference, quote, "What Secretary Kerry has done is unseemly and unprecedented. He ought not to engage in that kind of behavior. It's inconsistent with what the foreign policy of the United States is, as directed by the president. It is beyond inappropriate," unquote. Pompeo's statement at Kerry comes a day after President Trump accused the former Secretary of State of, quote, "illegal meetings with the very hostile Iranian regime," unquote, in a late-night tweet.
And has Kerry defended himself in any way, you know?
Well, it says here, Kerry, in a radio interview with Fox News as part of a book tour, said he had met with Iranian Foreign Minister Mohammad Javad Zarif, I'm sure I butchered that, three or four times since the end of his term in January 2017.
Was it because of the writing of the book?
Well, he said it was part of his book tour. He has also accused the Trump administration of pursuing an apology of regime change in Iran.
Huh. If it was about writing the book, and that's all they talked about, what happened in the past, that's not necessarily a slippery slope. But if he's talking about the present, he can't act as Secretary of State. He's no longer that.
Right.
Again, I don't know what happened, so I'm not making judgment on either side.
Well, you know, Glenn, though, one of the things that we do...
could be political, too, or an election.
One of the things that we try to do on this program, and of course... As a hallmark of modern American media is we try to, speculate as recklessly and as irresponsibly as possible.
Wow.
Well, I think it's important to do that, don't
you? The way
you
said that is something that would come out of Trump's mouth.
Trump doesn't use big words like irresponsibly.
No, but it meant the same thing with his smaller words.
No, Trump is...
Fake news!
Trump is far more articulate than I could ever be.
An anonymous, really an anonymous, gutless coward.
I mean, he's a wordsmith.
I stand up here giving speeches for an hour and a half, many times without notes.
Yeah, he can speak extemporaneously without notes. I mean, I'm using the word.
He made it very clear. Notes.
I'm using the word extemporaneous. I don't think he knows. I don't think he knows that that word.
Donald Trump. He's lost it up here.
Well, that's terrible news.
He said it, I didn't.
That's right, yes.
That's just a joke.
Of course it's a joke. We kid. We kid because we love. Right? No?
To an extent.
I mean, it's the Christian thing to do.
It is.
To love our
president. So is forgiveness.
Yes, you forgive our president for being a buffoon?
You can only do so much forgiveness. It's like crying wolf, and you say, "I'm sorry," and you say it 10 times in 3 months, and you wonder, do you know what it means? You're not sorry anymore because you don't know what it means.
That's right.
So anyway, I'm glad that I'm in Manchester, New Hampshire today and not in the Carolinas. I really feel bad for those people that are being hammered.
Yes. I wonder if the hurricane has affected our weather. It was supposed to get, like, brutally hot this week, and it never did.
It didn't, and we had a lot of cloudy days.
It was supposed to be, like, 90 degrees.
But it had nothing to do with that. It had to do with another front. Now, last night I heard on the radio somewhere, or I think on the internet radio, what it was, that they blame the Northeast for what's happening in the Carolinas because of the high that we have. Well, it's not very high if we had all these clouds all week, right? There had to be a low somewhere.
Where's Al Caprillion when we need him? He would know the answers
to
this.
He would know the answer. But it's supposed to be nice till Monday night, and then late Monday night into Tuesday, Flo will be here visiting us. We can get as much.
We're getting a visit from Aunt Flo? Is that what you're saying?
Aunt Flo or whatever.
I didn't think...
Flo will be here, and she will be dumping between 1 and 2 inches of rain.
I don't think we're all getting a visit from Aunt Flo.
Up to 2 inches of rain, they said.
If you know what I mean.
And maybe winds between 40 and 58. But you know what? By the time it gets here, who knows what happens? It'll be pretty much diminished. So if we get 2 inches and we only get winds of 4 to 58 miles an hour for a day, we can handle that.
Can you?
I can. Can you?
I guess.
Better, 2 inches is better than 4 feet.
That's right.
And in 3 days' time, not 14 days' time.
That's right.
The last time that happened in the Carolinas, they said it was in a period of 14 days, which is 2 weeks. This is going to happen in a period of 3 days.
My goodness. You should be a meteorologist.
No, I just like to know my facts. I will tell you that when the eye started widening as it slowed down, the slowing down made the eye wider. What that did is it spread it into a, even though it's only category one, it made it a wider storm, and now all of a sudden it's a 500-mile storm.
Listen to what you know about eyes. You should be an optometrist.
It is affected by a lot. Now, right now they're saying the eye is shrinking again, and that's probably good in one sense. At least it will downsize that monster. But it's only moving between 3 and 6 miles an hour back and forth. So it's not going. That's the reason why it's doing exactly what it did in Houston. It stalled.
You could be like a dual meteorologist and optometrist or ophthalmologist. Have you considered that?
No, I'll tell you what I have considered all my life. That's why I went to college just for that. I didn't want a degree. I studied in 12 minors because I wanted to be a jack of all trades and a master of none. I leave the stuff of being a master to the guy upstairs.
Oh, who's upstairs? Is Brendan up there today?
God.
Oh.
It's Brendan. Brendan's gone home. It's a long weekend.
I wasn't sure when you said upstairs. I thought, okay. Hey, did you see that? So Reason.com has a story up.
Certainly not upstairs in Trump's head.
All right. Man wrongfully sentenced to 50 years in prison goes free after dog he supposedly killed is found alive and well.
You know, that happens a lot. And a lot of it is a unique way of finding out. But a lot of it is proven through DNA now that we didn't have years ago.
Yes.
And it's sad that that's the reason why I'm glad that the death penalty did not. Did it change or did it not change on Thursday? They tried to.
Here in New Hampshire?
Yeah, they tried to veto the governor. I'm not sure. Someone would know. Give us a call. Did they change the death penalty in New Hampshire not to allow it, or did they just leave it the way it was for those that murder officers or important politicians?
I know they've tried to get rid of it completely before. I'd like to get rid of it completely.
I think that's what happened. They didn't get rid of it completely because somebody said they're going to bring it up again next year, although it got close.
Because I think there was an attempt to by the legislature, and then Sununu vetoed it.
Yeah, so that's exactly. So actually, it stayed the same then.
Yeah.
That's, you know, I can understand. But you know what? Murdering, two wrongs don't make a right, and spending their life in jail, I think, is a pretty good punishment.
Well,
it's sad that it costs us money, but.
Well, it's cheaper to
keeps us safe.
Stick someone in prison for the rest of their life than to execute them. Plus, I've always said, I mean, Mikey.
Well, how do you say it's cheaper?
It's extremely expensive to execute someone.
Oh.
With all the appeals, that too. Yeah, that's become more and more expensive. Yeah, it's actually very expensive to execute someone. But my key argument against the death penalty has always been that, look, it's not a perfect system. And sometimes people are convicted of things that they didn't actually do.
And that's the reason why I want to change. If we had a perfect system, then that's fine. But we don't have a perfect system. And when you find out 20 years later that a guy or a lady was murdered because of the death penalty and they didn't commit the crime, that's sad.
Right. That's why I support, you know, like the Innocence Project and organizations like that.
It's like when you hear of a person spending 10 years in jail and then they're pardoned because they were found innocent through the DNA.
Yeah.
And what do we give? They've lost 10 years of their lives.
Right. Well, this is an interesting case. It says here, Joshua Horner was convicted of sexual abuse. His victim claimed he killed her dog to keep her from talking, but the dog is fine. This is wild.
And how long was this guy in jail?
I don't know. We'll see what the story says. It says here, a dog may have spared a Salem, Oregon man from a 50-year prison sentence for sexual abuse of a minor. The fact that the dog is still alive contradicts key testimony used to convict the defendant, who had already been released from prison and is no longer facing a possible retrial. In this very strange and slightly confusing tale, plumber Joshua Horner was convicted in 2017 of abusing a minor, who testified that Horner had threatened to shoot her animals if she ever squealed on him to the cops. To prove he was in earnest, she said, he shot her dog. But after Horner appealed to the Oregon Innocence Project, the group realized that if it could find the dog, Lucy, it would be proof that the alleged victim had lied under oath. The Oregonian reported that when the project, quote, raised concerns in April about the case with Deschutes, I don't know if I'm saying that right, County District Attorney John Hummel, he agreed to work with them, unquote. Let's hear it for a DA willing to revisit a case. The folks at the Innocence Project became human bloodhounds on the trail of the dog, a black lab with distinctive ears and coloring. Somehow they ended up tracking her down. As Fox News reported, the dog's existence showed the complainant was lying in her testimony. Enough evidence for County District Attorney John Hummel to request the case be dismissed. The woman also failed to show up for a meeting in August to address her statement. Lucy, the dog, was not shot. Lucy, the dog, is alive and well, Hummel's office said in a statement.
Could she be found for perjury?
The dog?
No, the lady.
I would think so. And I would hope so.
Didn't you say earlier in the article that he's already had been released from jail? He already served his sentence. How long was his sentence, though?
I don't know. Yeah, it doesn't say that here. But Hummel said on Monday, quote, "Well, I cannot say with certainty that Mr. Horner did not sexually abuse the named victim. I can say I am not convinced by a preponderance of evidence that he did, and I am certainly not convinced beyond a reasonable doubt," unquote. While we're on the subject of reasonable doubt, even a jury that convicted Horner was not unanimous. How is that legal? It turns out Oregon is one of two states where jury decisions need not be unanimous,
really?
Even when the outcome will result in a person spending 50 years in a cage. That's interesting.
Who's the other state, does it say?
Doesn't say.
Do you know?
I hope it's not New Hampshire.
No, I know it's not New Hampshire.
to add one last layer of weirdness to this story, Horner was already out on an appeal as of August 3rd. According to the Oregonian...
Oh, he was out on an appeal.
Yeah. According to the Oregonian, the Oregon Court of Appeals reversed his conviction and ordered a new trial. The appeals court said the defense had not been allowed to present certain evidence that was unrelated to the dog. Now, Horner no longer faces that second trial. He declined a request for an interview, saying he is not ready to speak with the press just yet. After Lucy was found, no complainant filed to attend a meeting in August to discuss her testimony, Hummel said. Last Wednesday, one of the investigators heard she was at a home near Redmond. When he pulled up to the driveway, she ran away.
Who pulled up to the driveway? The defendant?
No. The investigator pulled up to get the defendant, and she ran away.
And she had the dog with her?
No. The dog was somewhere else, but the defendant is trying to... Because the defendant knows. I mean, she must know she's in trouble for lying.
Of course.
So, and then the article concludes with this. A case of rough justice all around. And rough is spelled R-U-F-F. Oh, Reason.com. They're funny. I love Reason.com. No, I do find very interesting stories on there, but there you go. And for anyone who doesn't quite connect the dots, how does that relate to the death penalty? It relates because, again, it's an example of how the court system is faulty, and sometimes people are convicted of things they did not actually do.
Say instead of 50 years in prison, he would have been charged the death penalty, and he would have been murdered before they found out. We would have killed another innocent person.
That's right. That's right. And it does happen. It absolutely does happen.
It happens too often, actually.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's not as rare as we think it is. We hear about it a lot.
Yes.
Too often.
Yes. Absolutely. There was a story about the economy from Reuters. Kind of a mixed picture here. U.S. incomes rose, but inequality widened in 2017. Oh, actually, here, let's grab this. We have a call, and then we'll get to this other thing. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton, Unleashed in the Afternoon. Who's this?
This is This is just some random caller.
This is just some random caller. Hello, sir.
Hi. Can I make a request?
It's a familiar voice. Yes, you can. I can't promise fulfill it, but
No. This is just some random caller, trust me.
Okay. This voice is familiar to me. But okay.
No. This is just some random caller.
Is the voice familiar to you, Glenn? The voice is familiar to me. Anyway, yes, go ahead, sir. Random caller, yes.
I would like to request a song, and I would like to dedicate it to both of you.
Man on Your Mind by Little River Band?
You're funny.
No, that's a good choice.
Isn't that a great song?
I would like to request Dr. Love by Kiss.
Ooh. Except, not to correct you, random caller, I believe the song is Calling Dr. Love.
Yes.
Calling Dr. Love by
that
Kiss.
Is correct.
Yes. Now, is that for both of us, or is that specifically for the People's Mayor, Glenn R.J. Ouellette?
No, he said it was for both of us.
Because Glenn is not only the People's Mayor, but he's...
You're just as privileged as I am.
He's the People's Doctor, I say.
Oh, come on.
The People's Doctor of Love.
Stop it.
At least he was in the 70s. Anyway, and you are a big Kiss fan, Matt, so I'm dedicating that
voice
to both
is so
of you.
Familiar. Well, thank you. Thank you, random caller.
No. I'm just a random caller, and I know that you like Kiss because I'm a random listener, too.
Have you ever approached me in Walmart?
I might have bumped into you. You know, this is... a big city, and there are several Walmarts, and I might have. You know, many people shop at Walmart.
That's true, yes. There's a lot of people there. That might be where I've heard your voice before. Sometimes when I'm out in public, people just approach me.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
As we
I'm never on the radio and nothing like that.
Right, right. You have a very familiar voice. Have you ever considered being on the radio?
He's got a good voice for radio.
You should come in and join us on the show sometime. You still there? Did he hang up? I think he hung up. I didn't hear a click.
No, but I don't hear him anymore. You there? Call again.
Are you a big Kiss fan, Glenn?
I like Kiss. It's not my favorite band, but I like Kiss.
I'm going to play that at the end of the show, I think.
There
I'm
going
to play Calling Dr. Love.
Sounds good.
Is it in the system here, though?
I don't know
if it's in the system.
Google it.
And I'm in a little bit of a... See, I don't have my computer with me today, although I can still find it. But did you notice that, Glenn? Did you notice what's missing? What is conspicuous by its absence?
What happened to it?
It's at home. I just forgot it. So I had to do something. I had to run up to Concord earlier, somewhat unexpectedly, and
you thought you'd be home earlier.
Yes, and I was not. I should have planned better.
Should have put it in your vehicle, huh?
I should have. And you know what? And actually, I got here and I parked in the parking garage, the Victory Garage that I was parking. I probably shouldn't tell people that in case someone wants to shank me. But I did. I parked in the garage and then I was like, where's my bag? And then I was like, oh, it's in my office at home. It was very, I was very upset. I freaked out. I started freaking out and swearing.
Well, look, you're going to survive. Do we close early tonight because of the show behind you?
Actually, no, because apparently Rob is not going to be here, so we're going all the way to 6 p.m., baby.
There you go.
Yeah, I might play two Kiss songs at the end of the show.
Yahoo!
I might not.
Oh, you might not? Boo-boo, then.
What version am I going to play, though?
Oh, they have more than one version?
Well, there's, you know...
There was something out.
Whoops, I didn't mean to do that. There's, you know, the remastered and... I'll probably just play the original, though.
Yeah, play the original.
One of my favorite Ace Frehley guitar solos on Calling Dr. Love. But we're going to save that for the end of the show.
Good closing song.
We'll allow the anticipation to build. I'm glad some random caller requested that. That's nice.
I'm glad that lady sang today. She's got a great voice.
That lady? That was
a young girl.
A young girl,
yeah.
I think,
yeah.
Yes.
I don't know how old they are, but she sounded pretty young. She had a pretty good voice and powerful.
She did, yes. And but the only thing that concerns me a little bit is I wish that that's why you sound far away. I was just thinking you sound like you're far away from your mic, and then I look over at you and I'm like, oh, it's because you are.
I am.
There you go.
My voice carries.
Yes, but
not that much.
Right.
The only concern that I had is she mentioned it's a Beyonce song, and you know, as everyone knows, Beyonce and Jay-Z are part of the globalists and the Illuminati.
Yeah, you said that. Is that
with,
true?
With George Soros.
You think that's true?
There's a credible source.
A credible source.
Who says that. And,
how credible
and
is
I
it?
Believe him. He is so credible that he's been completely deplatformed, and it's hard to even access him anymore. That's how credible he is.
I thought you were going to say he's so credible that he can jump rope.
I don't get it.
It's a joke.
I don't get it.
Sense of humor.
I know. I don't get the joke, though.
He could jump rope.
He could jump rope, yeah.
So you said he can't be found, so.
Right.
He can jump rope.
Yeah.
Like jumping a wall, and I'm just gone.
Right. So it's like the more you explain the joke, the less I get it.
No, it's
like really
someone, someone saying something anonymously and not being confronted, they jump rope.
Right. So is that like an expression? Is that something?
Yeah, is it true?
Is that like
false?
Something they say in Van Buren, Maine or something?
No, it's not necessarily they say in Van Buren, Maine, but is it true or is it false?
Is what true or is what false?
Like jumping the border. Now you get it?
Jumping the border.
You never heard that expression? I jumped the border?
I've actually never heard that expression in my life.
You say I crossed the border? You ran across.
Right, I've never heard anyone say I jumped the border. You don't really jump a border.
No, it's an expression.
But where? Like
a cliche.
Like who says that?
Well, I guess I do.
Do they say that up in Quebec?
No, not necessarily. It depends if you say it in French, I guess.
Is that, yeah, I just don't know where I've ever heard that before.
Well, you don't hop the border either.
Right. Well, I think you could.
Could skip and hop, I guess.
Right, but why would you? That would draw attention from the Border Patrol if you start skipping and hopping.
Jumping the border would be as well. That means, you know what it means, jumping the border?
I mean, I've
it
heard
means
of jumping
you
bail.
You're sneaking yourself through.
Right.
And you could be caught.
Right. So that's, but how does the jumping rope play into this? You wouldn't jump rope while crossing the border. That would definitely get the Border Patrol's
expression.
Attention.
You're doing something sneaky.
So it's sneaky to jump rope? We used to jump rope in gym class when I was a kid.
No, it's sneaky to get across the border when you're not supposed to.
Right.
So instead of saying run.
Yeah.
I said jump.
Right.
It's just an expression.
But where does the rope come into play?
Rope, well, when you jump, you know, a lot of people jump rope. They do jump rope.
Yeah.
So it's just an expression. That's all it is.
A lot of times boxers jump rope, like Rocky would jump rope. Is that where you got that from, Rocky, maybe?
Not
the Rocky movies?
No. Lots of people
maybe
jump
they
rope.
Say that in Philadelphia. They
kids
talk about
jump
jumping rope
as well. You know, everybody. Yeah. Senior can jump rope.
Well, the thing is, I was talking about Alex Jones, and I'm going to go out on a limb here and say, I don't think he jumps rope.
No, what does he do? Run rope? I mean, run across the bridge?
I don't know if he... I don't think he runs across bridges either. I think he drives.
Ooh.
No, I could be wrong.
Could be. Could be right.
I'm still... Yeah.
Let's move on.
What other strange expressions do you use that no one else uses?
Whatever comes out of my head.
Well, apparently... All right. Well, boy.
Blueberry.
A blueberry what?
Blueberry iced tea.
No, don't advertise that you're drinking that in here. We're not supposed to have anything but water in here now.
Well, it's made with water.
It's made with water. Very good. Now, okay, I can't argue with that. It is a fluid-based product. It is made with
water. Water drink, yes.
It is a water drink,
it
yes.
It is watered down.
Well, we're water. We're like two-thirds water or
That's
something.
That's correct.
Yes. That is correct. It's all true.
So what do you think about after 4 years what happened to Flint and they haven't corrected the system? They're still being poisoned.
Yeah, they Flint, Michigan. Yeah, they still don't have...
Isn't that crazy?
It is. They still don't have good drinking water in Flint, Michigan.
But it's a low-income community and it's a African-American community and you have to wonder why. If it was a white community and a rich community, you think that would still be there? Think about it.
So I think, hello to Brian Gavostas, by the way, who joins us in the Facebook live chat, also known as Beasley B Musical. So I think.
I'm just putting it out there and have no proof. But, you know, you have to wonder, 4 years.
I think if it were a rich community, yes, this absolutely would have been solved very quickly.
Yes.
I don't know that race has anything to do with it. I don't know about it being I think there are a lot of white people there. But I don't know.
But it's an overly African-American. They have more African-Americans in Flint than they are any other minority, or any other diversity.
Right.
It's known as that. And that's the sad part. And it doesn't matter if it was a black community or a white community, to be honest about it. The point is, it's been 4 years, and what has the government done? Nothing. And the people involved are still in office.
Yeah. Well, look at Puerto Rico.
Yes.
I mean, you know, they've still got problems there.
It's funny that he said he thinks it's more like 18 when last year he had accepted the 64. And now we know that out of over 2,000 that applied for the government to pay the funeral, 75 were granted. Well, doesn't that at least say that 75 were considered part of that? I mean, come on. First of all, they should be talking about what's going on today.
Right. What's going on today? Something happened?
Florence.
Oh, yeah.
And making sure that we don't repeat what we did in Puerto Rico.
Right. Well, I mean, certainly.
And then they found 120,000 crates on the airport that still have the water, which is all covered up with blue tarp. And that water's been there almost a year now. So guess what? I wouldn't drink that water after all the heat that they have there. How many times has that water boiled over?
Yeah. So just to clarify, I had an article about it. I don't have it handy now.
You should see the picture. Actually, it's on YouTube as well.
Yeah. Yeah. They left. Trump talks about what a great job the government did in Puerto Rico, and there's an instance of all this bottled water that's been sitting on a dock for more than a year.
Well, there's one thing he did do.
That those people could really use.
He at least made sure the water got to the airport. He just didn't allow it to be distributed to the people who actually needed it.
Well, what they need is for him to go back there and throw the water like he did the paper towels. And
that's
then everyone
else.
Will have water.
If I need a lifeline from flooding and all you're going to give me is a roll of paper towels, how is that going to save someone's life?
I found the...
That was so... stupid.
I found the article. This is from Reason.com. It says,
oh, really?
Sarcastically, it says, tremendous job. FEMA left a million bottles of water.
It's
on
a million, even bigger.
On a Puerto Rican airstrip for a year.
Yep.
But yeah, I'm sure FEMA is ready for Hurricane Florence.
I think it's 120,000 crates, and it adds up to probably a million bottles.
Yep. Says here,
it's a lot of water.
As another major hurricane bears down on the U.S., Trump has told reporters the federal government's response last year to last year's storm in Puerto Rico was tremendous and one of the best jobs ever done. Almost on cue, pictures surfaced Tuesday night of what CBS News says is nearly a million bottles of water dumped on an airstrip in the aftermath of Hurricane Maria, which hit Puerto Rico last September. By Wednesday morning, the Federal Emergency Management Agency, FEMA, confirmed that, yes, those were bottles of water that never reached any of the stricken Puerto Ricans, more than 3,000 of whom died in the aftermath of the storm.
In fact, it is Trump that finally said, after a few months, that they were going to stop giving bottled water, even though lots of people still didn't have water. And now we're finding out there was water right there in the airport that was paid for by taxpayers' money, and now it's just rotting away.
Of course.
Shameful.
It says here it's unclear who exactly is to blame, but there's no doubt that the government screwed up. According to CBS, FEMA says it gave the water to the government of Puerto Rico, who failed to distribute it. The images of all that wasted water sitting on a runway might be infuriating, but they're sadly unsurprising. Given FEMA's track record, which Reason's Joe Satan explored in detail earlier this week, this is pretty much what we've come to expect in the wake of natural disasters.
As sad as that is, that's so true, isn't it?
Absolutely. The same can be said of Trump's willingness to claim that the response to Maria was a success. While the current president's propensity for hyperbole makes his assessment seem particularly inaccurate, it's really not much different from George W. Bush claiming that Michael Brown, the then director of FEMA, was doing a hell of a job in the wake of Hurricane Katrina while federal workers were wasting $2 billion in disaster aid and blocking private agencies from lending a hand.
I will never forget that. Well, we got to also realize that when, was it called Maria, the last hurricane they had in Puerto Rico?
Yes.
Yes. Well, they were not allowed to do what they did in Houston. Instead of having, they were, anybody who had boats or barges were allowed to bring in the stuff. In Puerto Rico, the government contracted and only certain businesses could do it. And that's why, first of all, it took so long for stuff to get there.
Yeah. There's another example in here, too. Barack Obama and New Jersey Governor Chris Christie sharing a bro hug on the beach after Hurricane Sandy, even as FEMA was running out of water and failing to deliver the 24 million gallons of free gas it promised to the storm's victims. For what it's worth, FEMA now acknowledges that it dropped the ball in Puerto Rico. In a report released in July, the agency described the supply shortages, outdated equipment, and unprepared staff that caused problems in Maria's aftermath. This morning, Trump tweeted, this is from a couple days ago, this story, but it says this morning, Trump tweeted that FEMA is ready for the big one as Hurricane Florence bears down on North Carolina. The cycle begins again.
We can only hope that this time it's the truth.
Yes.
We'll soon find out.
Hello to Fred Bonig from thedailyripple.org, who joins us in the Facebook live chat. He says, way to go, Brownie, referring to, of course, Michael Brown and George W. Bush's praise of him. And then he says something about the Jones Act. Yeah, I'd forgotten about that, the Jones Act, which Trump took his time. I'm no expert on that, but it was something where Trump really kind of took his time on deciding whether to, by executive order, offer Puerto Rico a waiver, the Jones Act, which I'm looking it up now because I want to make sure I get it right, which restricted a lot of shipments. Okay. The Jones Act is a federal law that regulates maritime commerce in the United States. The Jones Act requires goods shipped between U.S. ports to be transported on ships that are built, owned, and operated by U.S. citizens or permanent residents. It is also known as the Merchant Marine Act of 1920.
Except in the Gulf course, they waived that.
Well, yeah, they eventually, so there's, PBS has something here, the Jones Act explained and what waiving it means for Puerto Rico.
Because they were considered a different country, which actually they're all Americans.
Well, of course, yeah, but a lot of people don't realize that, and I think Trump himself forgot it at one point.
I think he's still forgetting it.
Yeah, it says here officials in Puerto Rico praised Trump for temporarily waiving the 1920 Jones Act, which they said would help provide faster relief. But what exactly does the waiver do, and will it actually help? And then there's a breakdown here of, we don't have time to get into it in detail, but there's a breakdown in this article of what it does, why it was created, and what waiving it means. But
I will only say that Trump this week did not show any sympathy of people's loved ones in Puerto Rico who died because of the hurricane.
Oh, it's incredible. I'll tell you what.
That is sad for a president.
If we needed any further evidence that he's truly is a legitimate sociopath and capable of empathy, I think we saw it with that. He really just doesn't care.
Somebody said last night his heart is so deep in his soul that he can't reach it.
Yeah, he really just...
I hate talking like that, but you know what? When you get to know someone eventually and there's no term, you have to really wonder what is going on in their heads.
Yeah.
It's called me.
Yep.
Donald Trump, he's lost it up here.
Yeah, that's all he cares about.
Yeah.
That's all he cares about is himself.
Oh, the next thing you'll hear him say is that the Democrats cost Flo. Wouldn't surprise me.
Oh, yes. You were talking earlier about Aunt Flo's coming to visit.
Yeah.
Yep, that's exciting. Well, I mean,
you meet her at the City Hall?
Not everyone will be happy to hear. Not everyone likes it when Aunt Flo comes to visit.
She don't come that often. It's a good thing.
Not every, 28 days or so?
No. What are you talking about? We don't have hair.
What are you talking about? Are we talking about the same thing?
We're talking Flo.
You said Florence. You said Aunt Flo was coming to visit.
No, you said Aunt. I talk Flo, which is Florence,
oh,
for Hurricane Florence, which will be a tropical storm by then.
You don't have an Aunt Flo?
I know an Aunt Flo.
Remember
I
Flo?
Don't have an Aunt
Remember
Flo,
Flo from, yes, Alice? Kiss My Grits?
Yes, yes.
She used to tell Mel, kiss my grits.
And Flo, the Sunbeam commercial lady, passed away in May. She was from Manchester.
I remember hearing about that.
Yeah.
It was like, wow, yeah. Is she the biggest celebrity ever to come out of Manchester? No, that would be Adam Sandler,
yeah,
I guess.
Yeah, for sure.
So really.
And we've had generals and all kinds of.
But really, so it goes, like, if you were to make a pecking order, it goes Adam Sandler and then Flo, the Sunbeam lady.
That's the modern
and then,
day.
And then Glenn R.J. Willette, the people's mayor.
No, near. I'm just a common folks like you are.
You're just a common
That's
folks.
That's all I am. That's why I'm called the people's mayor. I don't work for the government.
Oh,
I work for the people.
Right.
There's a difference.
Maybe you should work for the government. You could fix the government.
I cannot be sold.
Okay. Well, that's good. All right. Well, we are about out of time. We'll start to wrap up. Glenn R.J. will let the People's Mayor. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me. And all have a great weekend. It's going to be a nice weekend, so enjoy it. Oh, we should advertise the festival this weekend.
Oh, there's a festival.
Yes, the Greek festival at St. George's Cathedral on Hanover Street. Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. It's already started.
I can't go to that. I'm not Greek.
You don't have to be Greek to go to that.
Oh, well, that's good news. I didn't know that. Perhaps I'll get a Greek salad. I do enjoy feta cheese.
I actually go and film, and I actually have someone filming me doing the Greek donuts.
Oh, wow. You have someone film you filming.
Yes, the reporter, how you make donuts.
Right.
The Greek donuts.
Well, that sounds exciting.
It's a lot of fun.
Yes. And if you miss any part of today's show, it'll be up in just a little bit at WMNHradio.org. Thank you for that. Thank you to the anonymous caller earlier. And, of course, thank you to Pandora's friend. For singing to us, and Pandora for calling, and lots of excitement. And again,
all the other callers you had.
Frankie, if you're out there listening, I do apologize. Like I said, when you approached me in Walmart, you just freaked me out. I thought you were going to shank me. Yes, a very busy day for calls, and we will end with, per request, here it is, my favorite band. Little song called Calling Dr. Love. To finish out today's Matt Connerton Unleashed in the Afternoon, and I'll be back on Monday. I will talk at you then.
Au revoir.
Yes, and wee-wee or something. Bye, everybody.
Great weekend.
You need my love, baby, oh so bad.